Open your Bibles to Mark chapter 7. Mark chapter 7. The Gospel according to Mark chapter 7. I'm going to read from verse 14. Mark chapter 7, verse 14. He says, "And when he had called all the people unto him, he said unto them, Hearken unto me, every one of you, and understand. There is nothing from without a man that entering into him can defile him. But the things which come out of him, those are they that defile the man. If any man have ears to hear, let him hear. And when he was entered into the house from the people, his disciples asked him concerning the parable. And he said unto them, Are ye so without understanding also? Do ye not perceive that whatsoever thing from without entereth into the man, it cannot defile him, because it entered not into his heart, but into the belly, and goeth out into the draught, purging all meat. And he said, That which cometh out of the man, that defileth the man. For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within and defile the man." So clearly, Jesus is talking about what defiles a man. What you accept into your heart, what becomes a part of you and you allow to govern you, then that is what defiles you. The evil that you're exposed to is what defiles you. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 33. It says, "Be not deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners." In Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. Proverbs 4, verse 23. The Bible says, "Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life." The topic of my sermon this morning is guard your heart. You can say keep your heart, but you know, modern language, you say guard your heart. Jeremiah 17 verse 9, Jeremiah 17 verse 9, Bible says, "The heart is deceitful above all things, and desperately wicked, who can know it?" The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? The nature of man is corruption. Man is corrupt because of sin. And that spiritual corruption leads to... the spiritual corruption came when God... Actually, I'm being distracted. Please, if you have babies and they can't keep quiet, you can just go down. Or, you know, leave the auditorium if you can, if you have babies and they can't keep quiet. Amen? All right. The nature of man is corrupt because of sin, and man is in bondage to sin. When God said, "The day you eat of this fruit, you shall surely die," he meant that man would die spiritually, because man is three parts. I'm not going to dive into that, but man was dead spiritually. The spirit that God gave man, you know, God breathed into man and man became a living soul. So man has a spirit that is created in the image of God, because God is spirit and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So that part was dead, and that's why when you're born again, the spirit revives, it comes back. You know, the inward man is back alive. So that is what it's talking about. So man died, and that led to the destruction of flesh. And when Jesus comes again, our flesh is going to be redeemed. Because right now, if you're born again, your spirit is alive, but the flesh is still corrupt. Amen? But when Jesus comes back, there's going to be the resurrection of the dead, right? Our flesh will be redeemed. It's a physical, you know, redemption, because spiritually, we're already, you know, redeemed. Amen? So Jesus has set us free from the bondage of sin. That's what he came. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. And therefore, we can assimilate his word. I'll briefly go through some Bible verses to explain that. Open to Zechariah. Zechariah chapter 7. I'm going to read from verse 9, Zechariah chapter 7, verse 9. If you're there, say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Ah, Zechariah, come on, guys. I'll read from verse 8. And the word of the Lord came unto Zechariah, saying, thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, execute through true judgment and show mercy and compassion every man to his brother, and oppress not the widow, nor the fatherless, the stranger, nor the poor, and let none of you imagine evil against his brother in your heart. Verse 11, but they refused to hearken and pulled away the shoulder and stopped their ears that they should not hear. Yea, they made their hearts as an adamant stone. So when you refuse to hearken, they turned away their shoulders, you know, they stopped their ears from hearing that they should not hear what Jesus was saying. They made their hearts like a stone, an adamant stone, lest they should hear the law and the words which the Lord of hosts has sent in his spirit by the former prophets. Therefore came great wrath from the Lord of hosts. Therefore it is come to pass that as he cried, they would not hear, so they cried, and I would not hear, saith the Lord of hosts. But I scattered them with a whirlwind among all the nations whom they knew not. Thus the land was desolate after them, that no man passed through nor returned, for they laid the pleasant land desolate. So what is God saying? God is prophesying through Isaiah, saying what happened to Zechariah, saying what happened to the Israelites. God's law was coming. Jeremiah was prophesying, turn back to God. You know, stop doing these evil things. But they stopped their ears. They turned their shoulders. They did not want to hear the law of God. So they themselves made their heart as a heart of stone. You know, you think God is the one that just wants to punish people. It's when you refuse God, you reject God, then your heart becomes a heart of stone. You cannot hear the word of God, and the wrath of God comes upon you. A good example is Pharaoh. God through Moses and Aaron, told Pharaoh, let my people go. And Pharaoh said no. Pharaoh hardened his heart. By the fourth time or so, remember, they kept coming back every time. By the fourth time, the Bible says God hardened his heart. You know, when you harden your heart, when you turn your ears, you make your heart as a heart of stone. So God likens a heart of stone as a heart that cannot hear the words of God. And by the words of God is the law of God. You know, the laws. For example, I said women should submit to their husbands in everything. And some women will be like, no, that I'm not doing that. You're hardening your heart. You're turning your heart into a heart of stone because you don't want to hear the laws of God. You know, it's the laws of God, it's not always sweet. This is not Joel Austin, amen? Where, oh, just believe, it will happen. You know, everybody's happy. They all feel happy after service. By the time you hear the word of God, it's like a mirror. You fix something. You know, it hurts you. Because if it doesn't hurt you, no one is perfect. So the word of God has to hurt you somewhere. If not, I'm not doing my job. Open to Ezekiel. Remember what happened when he hardened their heart. When they hardened their heart, God scattered them among the nations because of his wrath. Ezekiel chapter 36. I'm going to read from verse 24. Ezekiel 36 from verse 24. The Bible says, for I will take you from among the heathen. Now, this is God's promise again to them. I will take you from among the heathen and gather you out of all countries and will bring you into your own land. Remember, he made the land of Israel desolate. He scattered them among the heathen. He scattered them among the nations because of his wrath, because they hardened their hearts. Now, this is what God is saying. Because the Bible says his wrath does not last forever. You know, his mercies, you know, endure it forever. God is merciful. So he's bringing them back. Verse 25 says, then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and ye shall be clean. From all your filthiness and from all your idols, I will cleanse you. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart. Did you see that? I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit within you, and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you shall keep my judgment and do them. statutes, judgments, precepts, all those things are synonyms of the law of God, the word of God. So look at that. That is a manifold prophecy. God was talking about what applied to them, and God is talking about exactly what applies to us as we are saved. Briefly, I'll run through it because that's not the main sermon. But he says in verse 25, I will sprinkle clean water upon you. The Bible says that the word would wash you like a water. No one is saved except they hear the gospel, the word of God. So when they hear the word of God, then they will be saved. He says, I'll sprinkle clean water upon you to wash you from your filthiness and from your idols, and I'll give you a new heart. So when you hear the word of God and you get a new heart, it is God that is working in you. Nobody is saved by his own will. Bible says it's not by the will of man. It's not by your flesh that you're saved. It's God that does the work in you. So a new heart also I will give you. He says I'll give you a new spirit. That is reviving the spirit man, the inner man. He'll make you alive. Behold, all things are passed away. And if any man is in Christ, is a new creature, all things are passed away and all things have become new, right? So I'll put a new spirit within you and I'll take away that stony heart. Bible says, my sheep hear my voice. So you preach the gospel, they are saved, then they start hearing the laws of God. Don't do this, don't do this, do this. This is how you should live your life. So you start hearing the law of God. I'll put within you a new, and I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. Why does it call it a heart of flesh? Because you assimilate the word of God. It's no more stony. And I'll put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. You don't say, I'll put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. People are like, the spirit led me to do this. The spirit led me to do this. If you tell me the spirit led you to do something that's not in the Bible, it's not the spirit that led you to do it. Because the Spirit glorifies God. The Holy Spirit glorifies Jesus. And guess who Jesus is? The Word. He says, my Spirit, when I send it to you, He'll remind you of the things that you have heard. The things that I've taught you. The Holy Spirit is not going to be leading you to do just every hour. The Spirit led me to give this guy $5 or to, you know, it has to be the Word of God. You know, people abuse that. The Spirit led me, the Spirit led me. So when I give you the Spirit, you walk in my statutes. Look through the Bible. Every time the Holy Spirit came upon some people and they were filled with the Spirit and they went out and prophesied. And they were filled with the Spirit and they went out and they spoke and they won souls and they did this and they did that. They're not just filled with the Spirit so they'll just be glorifying the Lord and you already have the Spirit of God. You're already revived. They say, let's go for a revival. They want the church to be shouting and clapping and everybody's happy. That's just emotional stuff. You have the Spirit of God. If you want to rejoice, rejoice. Why you're not rejoicing, why you're not happy, is because you're not doing the work of God. Read the book of Acts. And Paul, Peter, Peter, he and the other disciples, they went and they preached the gospel. They preached the gospel in the synagogue, they preached the gospel, and they persecuted them, they flogged them, and guess what? They rejoiced after the flogging. They were happy that they were suffering in Christ. But we want everything to be good, everything perfect, then we'll be like, the Spirit is moving. When the Holy Spirit moves, you go out, you win souls, you prophesy. He says, I'll pour my Spirit upon them, upon the sons and daughters, and they'll prophesy. You know, Paul and Silas, they did not wait for the Holy Spirit to fall upon them before they started singing and dancing. And when were they singing and dancing? In jail. In jail, you know, you're already revived. God has revived you. You know, Bible says in Psalms, will you not revive us again? Right? What does revive means? You know, bring us out of our captivity. Right? So they were revived at first, but they could not build the temple of God because things were happening. The king was fighting. That people reported to the king. I'm digressing a little bit, but I just want to talk about revival real quick. So I'm digressing a little bit. The king was preventing them from building the temple until they wrote letters and the king now allowed them. So during that time, the psalmist said, will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice? We are already revived. Revive means to be set free. Whom the Son has set free is free indeed. The Spirit is alive in you. So if you want to rejoice, rejoice. The Bible says rejoice. I say rejoice. And people, let's pray for revival. Let's pray. We're already revived. Do the works. Do the first works. You know, do what God says you should do. And when you're persecuted, rejoice. When they were rejoicing, they were persecuted. Amen? And when they are not rejoicing, they are out there doing the work of God. The Holy Spirit is fall upon them. They are prophesying. They are winning souls. They are moving the kingdoms of God. Moving on here, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 3 says, "For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshly tables of the heart." That is 2 Corinthians 3:3. Paul is saying that you are the epistles of God because God has written his law in your heart, not on tables of stone. What does that mean? He's not talking about the laws of Moses. You know, when God wrote the laws of Moses, he wrote it on stone, literally. Because he knew the kind of people he was talking to, they were going to be. He was telling Moses, these people are going to rebel. Because he knew they have the heart of stone. But he has given us a spirit where he said, I'm going to write my heart and my laws in your heart. Not on a table of stone where they will never receive the word of God. And now we are set free. We don't have to be in bondage to sin. You know, because our heart is no more heart of stone, but heart of flesh, because of the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Let's go to our Bible reading real quick. Proverbs 4.
Verses 20 to 27.
Thank you very much. Proverbs chapter 4, verses 20 to 27. It says, "My son, attend to my words. Incline thine ear unto my saints." Who is speaking here? Wisdom is speaking. Who is wisdom? Divine wisdom is from above. That's what the Bible says. Who is from above? Jesus Christ. Wisdom is the word of God. Wisdom is Jesus. Basically, this is Jesus calling out. Let me shorten it. It's just Jesus calling out. He says, "My son, attend to my words. Incline thine ear to my sayings." Don't turn your shoulder. Don't close your ears. He says, "Let them not depart from thine eyes. Keep them in the midst of thine heart." Remember, the heart is desperately wicked. Who can know it? God has changed our hearts. Has given us a clean heart, right? He has given us a heart of flesh that we can absorb the word of God. So guard your heart. Don't let the wrong things enter your heart. So incline your eye, your ears to my sayings. Keep your eyes fasting on the word of God. Keep reading the word of God. Verse 22, it says, "For they are life unto those that find them and health unto all their flesh." Literally, as a child of God, if you're doing the laws of God, you will have life. And life more abundantly. See, life and life more abundantly. You will live here on earth because God wants to keep you. Bible says, the harvest is plenty, but the laborers are few. If you're doing the work of God, God is like, I need this guy. I actually need him. Because there are not many people that want to do the work of God. There are many believers that don't want to come to church. There are many believers that don't want to do the work of God. They don't. And God is calling us to work for him. So it will be health to you. It will be life to your flesh. The king Hezekiah, because he walked with God, he asked for more life. And God gave him more life. 15 more years. Verse 23, he says, "Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life." He has given you this heart. Keep it. Don't get it messed up. Don't let the lust of the flesh destroy your heart. You know, instead, be led by the Spirit of God. And what is the Spirit of God? It leads you to the statutes of God, the laws of God. It magnifies it. It explains the things of God. It reveals to you who Jesus is. It reveals to you the heart of God. It reminds you of the things that you have read. That's what the Holy Spirit is here for. Verse 24, "Put away from thee a froward mouth and a perverse lips, put far from thee. Because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So put it far from you. Trying to say, don't let that be what is in your heart. Instead, fill your heart up with the word of God. "Let thine eyes look straight on, and their eyes look right on, and their eyelids look straight before thee. Ponder the path of thy feet, and let all thy ways be established." Paul says, "I examine myself every day." You know, ponder the path of your feet. Where am I going? Is this where God wants me to go? You know, maybe I should preach a message on what is the will of God concerning me. Because it's all in the Bible. What the will of God is. Bible says, where there is no vision, the people perish. But, But in the laws of God, there is rejoicing. So the vision is the word of God.
You know, some churches are like, oh, what's your vision? Vision is to have a mega church. You know, 1,000 people or above. No, the vision is the word of God. That is what a vision is. Verse 27 and the last, he says, turn not to the right, nor to the left. Remove thy feet, thy feet from evil. Don't turn to the right or the left. You know, go on, follow the word of God. Be careful of what you see, the lust of the eyes. Be careful of what you hear. Remember, my topic is guard your heart. I'm explaining what the heart is, the heart we have now as believers, and why you should guard your heart, because doctrines of devils are everywhere. Doctrines of devils in these end times. And the God of this world makes it readily available. You turn on your TV, TVN, they're just rubbish. I mean, they're just speaking devilish doctrines, and it's just to deceive you. 2 Timothy 3:13 says, but evil men, 2 Timothy 3:13, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. See, they'll be deceiving, and at the same time, they are being deceived. Why is that very important? Because when you look at this man that is preaching, this false prophet, he's so sincere. He means everything. He's doing everything he's saying. He means everything he's saying. So you say, there's no way this guy is lying to me, because he means what he's saying. He does what he's saying. But guess what? He's deceived. Jesus said, the blind leading the blind will fall into a ditch. So because he's sincere in what he's saying, does not mean it is the truth. How do you know the truth? Does he agree with the word of God? That is how you know the truth. So they are deceived, and if they are deceived, doesn't mean you should be deceived with them. Because if I'm wrong in something, then I'll totally convince you that I'm wrong already. The salt water cannot come out of a fresh fountain, right? That's what Jesus said. So another thing to know is sin is birth from the heart. James chapter 1, 13 to 15. James 1:13-15 says, let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempted he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust. Remember, I said, be careful of what you see, what you hear, all of that. The lust of the eyes. When you see something, you get tempted out of your own lust and enticed. Verse 15. Then, when lust has conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. So it comes out from within. Sin comes from within. From your heart, from the lust. So be guard your heart. That's my point. Always think on the right things, the pure things. Ephesians 4:8. He says, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things. It's a command. So if you're thinking on something wrong, that is wrong. That is a sin. Bible says the thought of foolishness is sin. So think on these things, as the Bible says. Let's learn from what caused the devil to fall. And I know we know the story very well, but look at Ezekiel chapter 28. I'll read a few verses. You don't have to open there. Ezekiel chapter 28. Bible says in verse 2, son of man, say unto the prince of Tyrus, thus saith the Lord God, because thine heart is lifted up. See, he's talking about the heart again. Because thine heart is lifted up, and thou hast said, I am God, I sit in the seat of God in the midst of the seas. Yet thou art a man and not God, though thou set thine heart as the heart of God. See how he's lifting up his heart so much. I'll jump to verse 5. He says, by thy great wisdom and thy traffic hast thou increased thy riches, and thy heart is lifted up because of thy riches. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, because thou hast set thine heart as the heart of God. See, God is focusing on the heart. Verse 15, he says, thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day that thou wast created, just like man and Adam, till iniquity was found around you. No, till iniquity was found in you. You know, the heart is always in. It's kind of like in the center. Like when the Bible talks about the heart of the earth, it's talking about hell. You know, so iniquity was found in the devil. Sin comes from within. is what comes out of the man that defiles the man. That's what Jesus said. Jump to verse 17. He says it again. Thine heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. So that's a lesson I want to learn from how the devil fell. God was looking at what was within. So always examine your heart. Amen. Make sure you know what is in your heart. The wise man said, ponder thy feet. So make sure you know what is in your heart, because God is looking at your heart. Deuteronomy chapter 8 verse 1. Deuteronomy chapter 8 verse 1 and 2. The Bible says, all the commandments which I command thee this day shall ye observe to do, that ye may live and multiply and go in and possess the land which the Lord sware unto your fathers. Verse 2, and thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness, to humble thee and to prove thee to know what was in thine heart. Did you see that? Whether thou wouldest keep his commandments or no. So God, the test that comes your way, the trials that comes your way, God wants to know what's in your heart. And it's not that God does not know. He's showing you basically what's in your heart. You know, he's revealing it to you. So God looks at the heart from the beginning. God does not look at, you know, the outside. I know we know that. God looks at the heart. Genesis 6 verse 5. Bible says, and God saw, you see, and God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And that's why Jeremiah says in 17 verse 9, that the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Because that's how it has been, you know. Verse 10 says, I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doings. So even his own children, he searches their hearts, and if they make their heart a heart of stone, his wrath comes down upon them. So don't focus on your thoughts. I'll say that again. I didn't make a mistake. Don't focus on your thoughts, your own thoughts. Let me put it that way. Because the psalmist says in 94 verse 11, Psalm 94 verse 11, it says, the Lord knoweth the thoughts of man, that they are vanity. Don't focus on your own thoughts. Remember, the Bible says, keep your eyes on the word of God. Always read the word of God. Incline your ears to the word of God. Think on whatsoever is true, honest, just, pure, lovely, you know, anything of good report. If there be any virtue, if there be any praise, that's what you should focus on. Not on your own thoughts. Give no thoughts of tomorrow. Give no thoughts of this. Not your own thoughts. Focus on the word of God. He says, I've been young and I'm old, and I'm not saying the righteous forsaken, nor his children beg for bread. Focus on the things of God, on the laws of God, the precepts of God. Because those are the things that will give you life, not your own thoughts, because they are vanity. Your beliefs and foundation should be the word of God. I like David. He said in Psalm 119 verse 11, thy word have I hid in my heart. You see, I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Proverbs chapter 2 verse 1, he says, my son, if thou will receive my words and hide my commandments with thee. So it's not just listening to the word of God, reading the word of God, and, you know, messing with it, playing with it. No, hide it in your heart. Because the mission of the devil is what? To steal, to kill, and to destroy. Remember the parable of the sower? The word of God was preached. The guy did not hide it in his heart. He did not understand it, and the devil came and stole it away. So I might preach and preach, and if you're not going to hide it in your heart and say, I'm going to hide these words in my heart so I will not sin against you, the devil is going to come and steal it away. You know, the cares of this world is going to come and choke it away. Things will happen and the devil is going to take it. So hide the word so that we don't become a prey to the enemy. Because he has created, he has made this world to work for him. That's why the Bible calls him the God of this world. And Jesus said, the prince of this world had nothing in me. Let that be our testimony in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let's bow our heads.